Hello, friends. Good evening, good morning, good afternoon, wherever you are. Welcome to the fifth episode of Caste Conversation. I'm Pradeep Pariyar. Caste Conversation is a dialogue to understand the caste dynamics that affect our society, our lives, and our value system. Caste Conversation is an initiative of Dalit Life Matters. Caste Conversation started few months back after the Rukum incident. So Dalit Life Matters Nepal is a social movement. We started that. So Dalit Life Matters Nepal is a social movement to create a just society where every Nepali can enjoy life without the fear of being persecuted in the name of caste. It is an initiative to counter and fight back all form of caste-based discrimination and untouchability, a collective intervention to ensure every right of every single Nepali citizen as guaranteed in the Constitution of Nepal. Dalit Life Matter Nepal is a connection with the people to build a collective force and amplify people's power to eradicate any inequality, discrimination, and violence based on the caste systems. Today's episode of Caste Conversation bring you Professor Dr. Sukhdev Thorat, who is well-known economist and professor emeritus at Jawaharlal Nehru University. So I don't need to give big introduction about the Professor Thorat because he's very well known in his sector. So especially he is very inspirational for million people. So he was the founder and director of the Indian Institute of Dalit Studies. Currently he is serving as a managing trustee at Indian Institute of Dalit Studies. Professor Thorat has also served as the chairman of University Grant Commissions and Indian Council of Social Science Research. Professor Thorat has worked more than 40 years in the areas of social exclusion and inequalities, linkage, economics of caste systems, market discrimination, labor market discrimination. He has published 19 books and over 100 research papers, in which 74 papers are on problem of Dalit tribals and minorities. Actually, he worked more than my age, actually. That's very interesting. And then he always inspired. In 2008, Professor Thorat was awarded the Padma Shri, India's fourth highest civilian award. Also, he has received Mother Teresa International Award, recently Baba Saheb Ambedkar Ratna Award, for his dedication and extraordinary contribution on the work and thought of Dr. Ambedkar. Professor Thorat, welcome to Caste Conversation. Can you unmute Professor Thorat? Yeah.
Am I audible?
We are not listening you. Can you?
Okay.
Yeah.
Just a minute. Maybe microphone is creating a problem.
Okay. Am I audible?
Yes. Great. Yeah. Thank you. Welcome, Professor Thorat.
Thank you.
Thank you for joining and thank you for giving time for us. It's a really great pleasure to welcome you in Caste Conversation. I have met Professor Thorat several times. Professor Thorat's dedication and contribution in promoting affirmative action and reservation policy always inspire me, and I'm always interested to learn more from him. So that's why Professor Thorat is here in our Caste Conversation. Let me begin with the context of reservation policy in Nepal. So I'll give you a brief context of reservation policy in Nepal. Nepal is one of the most diverse countries in the terms of ethnic, culture, religion, and language. Nepal is home to 125 different castes and ethnic communities. Dalit constitute 13.8% population of the total population. Constitution of Nepal 2015 guarantees inclusive and proportionate representation in the every section of the state. So that's in our constitution, but in reality, we have a different scenario. In political representation policy, there is a no reservation policy for the direct election system in the House of Representatives. But in the proportions representation system, there is a 13.8 reservation is secured for Dalit. In Public Service Commission, government has allocated 45% quota for marginalized community, and there is a 13% quota for Dalit out of 45%, but that's 9% quotas for Dalit out of 45%. So likewise, security agency, army, police, armed police force, Dalit has a 15% reservation, but it's among 45%. In education also, it's free for all up to grade 12. So there is a Education Service Commission, and then where teachers recruited, there is a 9% reservation policies. Unfortunately, the implementation part of the reservation policy is significantly low. The current quota system is not as per the population size. The current quota systems cover 45% and rest of 55% is free competition, which is gives like among 45%, if we talk about 13% or 9%, that goes lesser quota in our reservation policies. So that's the scenario of Nepal quota system. And it's a practices from like 10 years, and then it's a reviewing process is going on. And then everyone thinks that the quota system is bad, and there is a lot of debate on this issue is going on. So my first question to Professor Thorat, why is reservation is necessary for social inclusion? What is the purpose of reservation policy for Dalits and marginalized community? Let me repeat once again, why is reservation is necessary for social inclusion? Professor Thorat, you have 20 minutes for this, and then we'll ask a few more questions, and we have a participant who already sent some questions for us, and then we'll ask more questions. Floor is yours, Professor Thorat.
Okay, am I audible?
Yeah, can you a little bit loud?
Am I audible?
Yeah, audible, but...
Let me take out my microphone, because that creates problems. It's okay now?
Now it's good. Now very good.
Okay. When I will listen to you, I'll put on a microphone because your voice is low. But when I speak, I'll take out the microphone. Okay. Good afternoon to everybody. To you and to Sarita Periyar and all the participants. Nice to see you, all of them. You raise a very important question that why reservation is necessary. See, we generally have a policy for the poor, who are illiterate, who are low income, all over the country, anywhere in the world. But there are policies, special policy for those section, special and additional policies for those section, who in the past. Were denied equal right because of their background, social identity. Now, in our case, caste, we were denied the right to normal civil right to right to property, right to education, right to land and enterprises and education, and beside the civil rights, the untouchability keep them out of having an access to the public services and other public places. Now, therefore, for the poor in general, there is a policy which is developed to reduce poverty. But in case of discriminated community, in addition to the pro-poor policy, there has to be a policy which provide them safeguard against discrimination. For example, even if you give education to everybody, to scheduled caste, to the Dalit and the non-Dalit, equal education. But when the Dalit enter into the market, they will face discrimination in getting a job, or they will face discrimination in the electoral process. So as a result, in addition to the pro-poor policy, additional policies of providing a fair share and space to the discriminated group is developed in many countries of the world. Because discrimination doesn't remain in the past. For example, the discrimination with respect to Dalit is mentioned in Manusmriti and many religious texts, but it could, but despite legal ban, it continues even in the present. And therefore, you require a safeguard against discrimination, you require a law against discrimination, and you require a policy which will ensure their participation in various fields in proportion to their population, a fair participation. That is the main argument in favor of reservation policy. The generally speaking, if you take a look at the reservation policy, which is called by different name in America, it's a equal opportunity policy, empowerment, just as giving them the land, promoting entrepreneurship among them, that is for compensation for the denial of economic right in the past. Come to the jobs. Jobs in government, there is a reservation in proportion to the policy. Now here, I will talk to later, but in India and in Nepal, possibly, probably, the reservation in job is only confined to public sector, the government job. While in other countries like USA, Netherlands, and other countries, whatever policy they have, they have a policy both for public and the private sector. Then education is another field. In education institution, they get share in proportion to their population, public housing. And also, as you have rightly said about Nepal, in various governing bodies, you know, Dalit Commission, Public Service Commission, another commission where they get the share in proportion to their population. So broadly speaking, the reservation policy, what we call in India, provide a safeguard to the scheduled caste, to the Dalit. Now I'll just summarize that the reservation policy or safeguard against discrimination has a three component. First is the legal protection. First, there is a provision in the constitution. As a follow-up of that, there is a legal protection. In India, the untouchability is banned in the constitution. Banning of untouchability and providing equal right is a part of the fundamental right. It's not ordinary right, fundamental right. There is a provision in the constitution itself. So first, as a result of this constitutional provision, we have a law against untouchability, which is also later on improved as a law of prevention of atrocities, violence against scheduled caste. So you have a legal protection, so that if they do not get the equal right, they can go to the court and seek protection. So legal protection. And then, as I say, fair share in the various sphere of country's life, politics, economics, that is public job, education, public housing, and institution of governance, they are given a share in proportion to their population. Method may vary. I will talk about the method of election later on. And the third measure is that you should remember, which is not a part of reservation policy, but which is a part of a special policy for the scheduled for the Dalit, is economic enrichment, economic empowerment of theirs. In that particularly, we include the distribution of land. Because they were denied the land in the past, most of them are landless or have a small portion of land. So there is a program to give them the land. Then there is a program to promote entrepreneurship among them. They were debarred from businesses and enterprises. Even today, even if they start business, they face discrimination. The high caste in the villages would not buy good from them. So promote entrepreneurship. And then there is also procurement policy that since the high caste do not buy the goods from them, the government also come with a procurement policy. USA has a federal contract reservation. In India now, we have introduced about 20% reservation in government purchases from the scheduled caste enterprises. So that is it's a policy of reservation plus the economic empowerment policy. So these are three measures. Let me just summarize: legal provision in the constitution, legal safeguard for fair representation, reservation policy, and the policies of economic and educational empowerment also. Giving scholarship, constructing hostels for the scheduled caste, giving overseas scholarship. We have a big overseas scholarship program. We send about 100 students every year to the foreign countries for PhD. My own state of Maharashtra has about 100, more than 100 scholarship to undertake research in outside country. So education empowerment is also there in addition to the reservation in education institutions. So these are the broadly the policies that are there for the discriminated group, the reason is being that they continue to face denial of equal opportunity. They continue to face discrimination. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. There is a lot of work. There is a lot of work you done around Ambedkar. So you have also written on Ambedkar. What is the relevance of Ambedkar work on reservation policies and affirmative action? Actually, one of the our friend, Dr. Puna Nepali, also asks key feature of Ambedkar thought on Dalit reservation. So Could you please elaborate, especially relating Ambedkar and reservation policies?
Okay, my sound is audible. Ambedkar is almost like a father, and on par with Martin Luther King or more than that in India. The reason is that he was the one who articulated the problem of untouchable. There was a reservation policy for Muslim, for Anglo-Indian and Christian in 1920. But he was the one who studied the problem of untouchable, brought out their miseries, and proposed the reservation policy and economic and educational empowerment are there. But what is important is that he fight for it from 1920 to 1932 for a political reservation. And within 12 years, he got political reservation. And then 10 years later, in 1943, he managed to get a reservation in government jobs and education. He was a very towering scholar in India, but also in the world. So he was made the chairman of the Constitution, drafting committee of the Indian Constitution. That's why he called the father of the Constitution. So he then incorporated all the reservation policy provision in the Constitution. The untouchability was banned, provision for reservation was made, and there are several other provisions that he brought in Indian Constitution. But so whatever reservation policy is here, it is because of Ambedkar. Nobody else has done that. But more than that, he developed an anti-caste movement in India, mobilized the Dalit around his activity. He set up an organization called Bahiskrut Hitkarni Sabha. He set up Santa Sainik Dal. So the anti-caste movement, by setting up the institution, he was the first to start it in 1924. But he also set up the political parties to get political power and change the policies. He set up Independent Labour Party in 1937, converted that party into Scheduled Caste Federation in 1942, and that Scheduled Caste Federation was converted into Republican Party of India, which is present party, in 1957. So you can see that the untouchable, which was completely invisible in 1920, nobody recognized this as a group which is support from such a poverty and hunger and untouchability. He was the one who brought them, who made them visible, brought their issue on national level, fought with Britishers and Congress, and got whatever is here. But most important contribution of Dr. Ambedkar also is that he wrote very extensively. By undertaking the analysis of the caste system, problem of untouchables, exposing to the people how Hinduism is the cause of, and casteism is the cause of their downfall, massive literature. It is brought out in 21 volume by the Maharashtra government in English and also in Marathi. So that literature became a source of inspiration for the people. If they read it and they find solution, they get inspiration. So in summary, I will say that he was everything, and he has been everything for the Dalit in India.
I was
audible with microphone.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Go ahead.
Please go ahead. Actually, I just want to make a follow-up question on that. So when we talk about the reservation in India, there's issues about the Pune Pact. Can you all bit elaborate on Pune Pact things?
Yeah, I think I will also then related to the reservation policy in politics for Nepal. See, Pune Pact is nothing but the British government agreed to give in 1932 a political reservation to the scheduled caste in proportion to their population in central legislature in Delhi as well as in the provinces legislation in Delhi. See, in 1919 or 1920, when Ambedkar appeared on the political scene, there were political reservation for Muslim and there were political reservation for Anglo-Indian and Christian. Because they were considered to be minorities. So for minorities, they cannot come on their own through election process. So they were given
the political reservation, whereby in the election they could, certain seats were allocated to them and they could come in the parliament. Dr. Ambedkar argued that the problem of Dalit was more worse than that of a Muslim economically, and also worse than that of Anglo-Indian. So he asked for political reservation, that is, he asked for a seat in proportion to their population in the central legislature as well as in the provincial legislature. That was the demand, but it was opposed for quite some time. Finally, after 1920, he fought for 10 years. And in 1932, there were conferences in London where he took up the case. And it so happened that Britishers accept their demand, and they were given the political reservation. But Gandhiji opposed, and Gandhiji went on fast to death. And there was a huge drama in Pune. That's why it's called Pune, Pune Pact. He was in jail in Pune, imprisoned by the Britishers. So the negotiation with Ambedkar and Gandhiji took place in Pune jail. And finally, they were given political reservation. Now, you must understand one important point to draw a lesson for Nepal. The method of electoral method or political reservation for scheduled caste, there are two methods. One at that time which was accepted was what is called separate electorate. What we have today, because of opposition by the Congress at that point of time, is the political reservation. Now, there is a difference between the two. And this difference you must understand. For Nepal, you should prefer separate electorate. Now, what is separate electorate? Separate electorate is that you reserve certain constituencies in the country for the Dalit. Now, in that constituency, under the separate electorate method of election, in that constituency, only the scheduled caste will be the candidate. Only scheduled caste candidate will contest. You are double member constituency. A scheduled caste will contest and high caste will contest. From the reserve constituency, two people will contest, high caste, Dalit and non-Dalit. But the Dalit will have a right only vote to Dalit also, the Dalit candidate. No high caste will be allowed to hold the Dalit candidate. So only Dalit can hold Dalit candidate and Dalit will be elected by them. But the Dalit had also additional vote. They could also vote to a high caste candidate. And so they helped the high caste candidate being elected. The high caste will also vote to the high caste candidate. They are not allowed to vote to the Dalit. So the high caste candidate is elected by high caste plus Dalit, because Dalit has a double vote. Now, the advantage of the separate electorate system is that Dalit can elect the person of their choice and send in the parliament, so that he is independent. His election is not depend on the vote from the high caste. So therefore, he is independent and he can then take issues in the parliament. That is called a separate electorate. Now, the separate electorate was opposed. Therefore, we got a private, political reservation, which is the present reservation. What is the method under present reservation? Present reservation is that there are 82 constituencies, for example, at the center, which are again reserved for the scheduled caste. But these are not dual member constituency. Only the Dalit will contest the election, and Dalit and non-Dalit both will vote him or her. That is the difference. In the separate electorate, two candidates, and Dalit is elected only by the Dalit. In a reservation system, present reservation system, only one candidate instead of two, and both scheduled caste and scheduled tribe will hold them. Now, the disadvantage of the present reservation system, which you must understand for Nepal, is that since in all the constituency, in village, taluk, tehsil, wherever you go, in all constituencies, since the population of the high caste is more than majority, 70%, 80%, or 60%, depending on the population of the scheduled caste. But in any case, it is population is in majority, as a result of which it is only the high caste which will decide which scheduled caste candidate should be sent to the parliament. And Dalit, although they will vote, they won't have a power because they are in minority. As a result, you send a candidate to the parliament, which is a nominal candidate, not a real candidate. Because that candidate's election depend on high caste, so he will listen to the high caste. In the next election, if he need a ticket, he will listen to the high caste. He won't be an independent candidate. Therefore, Dr. Ambedkar tried the separate, he looked at once again at the time of constitution making. He also suggested the third alternative. Please listen to that. It is again useful for Ambedkar, because separate electorate was not allowed and political reservation was there, but that is not, in his view, effective. The third alternative was qualified joint electorate. Now, what is qualified joint electorate? Qualified joint electorate means the present reservation system. That is, there is only one candidate from the reserve constituency, both Dalit and non-Dalit will vote. That is the present electoral system. But he asked for a modification, that is, that let 3-4 candidates from Dalit will contest the election. As many candidates from Dalit can contest. But the one who get, once he get the vote, first the Dalit vote will be counted. And a candidate who get 25% to 30% of Dalit vote, it is only his vote, total vote will be counted for final election. Then the high caste vote will be counted, and then whosoever get maximum will be elected. Now in this case, Dr. Ambedkar's argument was that at least a Dalit candidate who get a maximum vote from the Dalit, because Dalit preferred him, he or she will be elected. But this was not also accepted by in the Constituent Assembly. Finally, what we have is the present reservation, where there is a one candidate, both Dalit or non-Dalit holds, non-Dalit being in majority, generally the candidate of their choice goes, and they are less effective, they are shy, and I'm not saying they are dishonest, but they know that they will not be elected next time, or there is a pressure, they have to follow the party's mandate. Generally, they are from the majority party. So this is the limitation of the reservation system. In Nepal, you should try, I don't know what is the method of election. I really didn't understand properly when you mentioned. We can have discussed that. You should have an electorate method. First thing in Nepal, you should have the seat reserved for the scheduled castes in proportion to their population, real population, not 13%. I read in the book that your population is perhaps 20 and more than 20%. So real population share. You should have a seat reserve in proportion to their population. Secondly, follow a electoral method which will allow the Dalit to elect their own candidate independently. If you have our system of political reservation and high caste being majority, and high caste and Dalit to vote that candidate, then always a candidate which is supported by the high caste will come in the parliament. So you should have a political electoral method in a manner such that Dalit vote will matter, that Dalit will be able to elect and send the person in the parliament. So he is accountable to the Dalit. Dalit can question him. Dalit can fight with him. Dalit can ask him to raise their question. Now, this is the story of the political reservation. Pariyar, I will send you a book or you can try on a webinar. Yeah, sorry, on that website where you can call for books and other things. A book by Rajshekhar Undru, you may be knowing, you might have heard him. He is a principal secretary in the Haryana government, but wrote a wonderful book on political reservation that discusses all these issues. I hope I have brought a clarity.
Yeah. I met him, and then he wrote another wonderful book about the Ambedkar and Patel. Same person, right?
Same person. So that is the only book he has written. Electoral system.
Yeah.
Making of India's electoral system, Gandhi, Patel and Nehru, Gandhi, Patel and Ambedkar.
Yes. I have actually that book actually.
Good.
With me.
Good. You should read and you discuss that. He discussed all this debate.
Yeah, that's great. Actually, I just want to mention this, that you brought wonderful perspective of India. Here we have in our electoral system, there is a direct election system where political parties give candidacy to their party cadre, but usually Dalit are not getting the from the direct election system. So we have a proportional representation system where they put the candidate list name, and then when when they got the vote for the party, and then they nominate their candidate. So that's that kind of system we have. And right now in our parliament, there is a 165 Dalit parliament, 165 parliament, and three Dalit parliamentarian who got chance to elect directly. And then there is other parliamentarian, they are from the proportional representation. So that kind of system. But this is interesting that we don't have a system, what Ambedkar argue, and then maybe we can discuss more on that. Maybe we need to brought this agenda in our next level of conversation and next level of campaign or movement. So that's an interesting phenomena. So you always talk about in your lectures and papers, you have talked about a contractual system in government jobs should be stopped. Why and how does it work with the private sector? We have when we talk about the reservation, that's always goes with civil surveyors and then political reservation. We never talk about the private sector. Could you please, as economics, you work on this more. So could you elaborate on this? How can we ensure the reservation in private sector?
Okay, good question. Now, whenever my voice is not audible, just call, let me know. I'll take out my microphone.
With
microphone, I can listen you better. Now, as far as the job reservation is concerned, Dr. Ambedkar in 1920 and 1930 built up an argument for job reservation that there should be a certain quota for the Dalit in the government job and even in private job, simply because there is a discrimination. That even if there are meritorious scheduled caste or meritorious Dalit, because of discrimination, even in public jobs, they are not taken. Similarly, in private sector, there is a discrimination. There is a discrimination in the military. There is a discrimination in police. I have heard you that there is some quota in military, there is some quota in commissions and all that. That is a progressive step. We don't have reservation in military. We don't have reservation in certain forces. But anyway, let me come to the job. See, the job reservation, as I mentioned earlier, is because of discrimination. How do you get a job? You get a job in the government or private sector, and government and private sector follow a procedure. That is, they make an announcement for the vacancy and prescribe the qualification. And then people apply. Then there is a written test and viva. And the people are picked up, appointed on the basis of merit. Now, in the case of Dalit, they are not picked up on their merit, is not taken into account to a greater extent, but their caste background, and they are discriminated because they are not supposed to be in a regular salaried job. Their only job as per the Manusmriti caste system is to serve the high caste as a casual laborer. So there is a discrimination. Therefore, the constitution provision in India is that, yes, you take merit. Minimum qualification, though, all those who meet minimal qualification, not the higher qualification, minimum qualification, they should have their share in proportion to the population. That is how the reservation started. But Ambedkar asked reservation simply because there is a discrimination. And since there is a discrimination both in public and the private sector, he asked for a reservation in both public and private sector. But since it was difficult at that time to have a reservation in private sector, he got the reservation in public sector. Both in 1932 in Pune Pact, there was a promise that they will be given fair representation. It was converted into a government decision in 1943, three years later. Now, therefore, we argued that there should be reservation in private sector also, because discrimination is more in private and less in government. But government did not listen to it. So finally, in 2003, you will recall that we had a liberalization program of which privatization was a major move. So the public sector undertaking were being privatized. And as a result, the job under reservation come down. So we asked for the reservation in the private sector. Private sector refused. They argued that our selection is based on the merit, so we don't need it. But there was a huge fight, academic fight, between 2003 and 2008. I was a part of that fight, and we convinced Dr. Manmohan Singh, who was a finance minister at that point of time, to have reservation. But finally, the private sector accepted some affirmative action policy. They did not accept reservation. Now, the affirmative action policy that the private sector accepted, which is there today, is voluntary and self-regulated. There is no binding, legal binding. There is no monitoring. It is the voluntary initiative of the private sector, the Confederation of Indian Industries, another association. In that, they have a threefold program. One is promoting education from the on the Dalit through giving scholarship. Number two, promoting professional education by again giving scholarship and orientation program and other things for them so that you make them eligible for recruitment in private sector. And third is promoting entrepreneurship, self-employment. So under self-employment, they give training and all that. They also try to procure the commodities from the scheduled caste entrepreneurs. So it could be called informal reservation in purchases by the private sector. This is the private sector reservation policy, but there is no reservation in job in the private sector. And I am now completing a book which bring out that there is a rampant discrimination in the hiring and employment in the private sector, both in employment and wages. So there is a need for reservation in private sector. Also, other countries have, for example, Netherlands, they have a equal opportunity policy. It is only for the private sector. There is no reservation in government sector. Government sector, there may be bypassing appointment and all that, but they cannot discriminate. So they have a policy of equal opportunity in the private sector. They have employment, Equal Opportunity Employment Commission. And that commission, from time to time, write to all the industries. Where the industries where they found that the proportion of the Catholic, they have two communities, Catholic Christian, Protestant Christian. Catholic Christian suffered discrimination. So they, whenever they find, on the basis of complaint, that some industries is not giving proper share to the Catholic, they will write a polite letter to them. That in your workforce, the proportion of the Catholic is not in proportion to the population. There are more of Protestants. Now the industry gets so damn scared because if that letter goes to the press, they will be defamed. So therefore, they politely make adjustment. So they have a monitoring in the for the private sector. We don't have anything in the private sector here. Nepal should have reservation policy for private sector because my feeling is with the kind of casteism and untouchability that you have in your country, there could be a rampant discrimination in employment in the private sector. You should ask for a survey. Whatever statistical system you have, you should have a column of knowing as to how many of Dalit are there in the private sector in various jobs. So this is how the system is there. Or you take any country, you take South Africa, you take Malaysia, you take Japan. The policy of reservation is for private sector. Public sector also is there, certainly. But that is giving a fair share, giving compensation to them, not because of discrimination as such. But for protection against discrimination, you require a reservation in private sector.
Great. Especially when I see over-representation of one community, one caste group, and then I always feel that as if this country is mine, but the state is not mine. So I always feel left out. So this is. We need to talk about the over-representation also. So I'm all these days talking about the over-representation also. We have questions from
Pariya, I forgot to answer one. You had asked about contractual labor. I have talked about private reservation for private sector. But now what has happened, the government has began to appoint the class 3 and class 4 employees on contract. 1 year contract, 3 year contract. And now as for the provision, there is no reservation in contractual position. It's in the regular position. So we need a reservation in contractual position also in the public sector. Some of the state have made, my state of Maharashtra, I'm told there is a reservation in the contractual position, post which are appointed on contract even in public sector. So that point also you should remember. Okay, go ahead to the second question. War representation, is that the question?
Yeah, that's not a question. That's just, I'm making one statement. So everywhere when I see over representation, I feel that this country is mine, but I never feel that this state is mine. That kind of feeling I have.
It's an important point that you are making. I would like to make 1 minute or 2 minute on that, because this is likely to come in Nepal also. You know, this the high caste now have in India have started a movement. That is, they say, save the merit and save the nation. So that is an argument against reservation. They say that they are Dalit are appointed with less qualification. Save the merit, save the nation. Now, in this, I would say that I think the caste system has been there from 200 BC for about 2000 years. And it continued till the Britishers came. In Nepal, the caste system, maybe for God knows how many years, ever since the caste system has traveled to Nepal, there also the caste system is there. Now, what is the principle of the caste system? Principle of the caste system is that education is confined to high caste, not to Dalit, even not to OBC. Now, if you have education, then the regular salary job will be ours. So the high caste Brahmin got the job in ancient India in government administration. They got the job in Mughal period in India. They got the job in the British period because they were the only educated. So we should use not only the concept of over-representation, as you have said, you should say that there was a reservation of the high caste and other were denied the space in employment. If they had a reservation by compulsorily denying education and entry into job, and we are discriminated, why should not we have? And they are overrepresented more than their share of the population. I think this argument has to make that Dalit are underrepresented in the regular salaried job, both in private and public, because they were denied and extra focus was given on the high caste. They should compensate for that, as a matter of fact. Go ahead.
Yeah, if you have any questions to Professor Thorat, you can ask here in chat box also. I have a request for all of you. If you have questions, please mention here in chat box. We have questions from Kishore Pradhan. What have been achievement of the reservation policy in India in uplifting the Dalits or mainstreaming? Are there comparative data available? So what are the major achievements after the reservation policy in India?
Very important question. You know, there is a misinformation that is being circulated that reservation has not helped. So if reservation has not helped, we should have another policy. That is a wrong propaganda. You know, the reservation for scheduled caste is to the tune of 16%. For the tribal, it is 8%. Now for under backward class, it is 27%. And now there are other castes, which are on the called OBC, they also get some reservation, but with a rider of income. So for other backward castes, certain categories of people with a certain level of income are excluded. Criminal, it is called. It's excluded. So relatively poor from OBC get reservation. There is no income criteria for scheduled caste and scheduled tribe. I can tell you one thing, that by and large, at all India level and in different state, the proposed share of the scheduled caste and share of the scheduled caste, particularly Dalit, is in proportion to their population, 15%, 16%. At time, they are overrepresented because they are overrepresented in scavenging. But the reservation is fulfilled. Now, within the categories A, B, C, D, C and D, the class 4 and class 3, there is enough and adequate representation. In B and C, you find there is a shortfall, 12%, 13%, 11% at time. But at the aggregate level, everywhere the posts are filled in. Now, as a result of that, what has happened? On the one hand, you have a public education system which is free, and then there is a reservation for scheduled caste, so they go for education. And once they get educated, then through the channel of reservation, they get into the government job. So reservation in government job has been a instrument of economic mobility for the scheduled class. The lower middle class, the middle class and little upper class that you see in India is entirely, it's predominantly because of jobs that they got through the reservation, and it brought a mobility. And once one generation get it, their children get it, So you are on the path of movement. So reservation has certainly helped. Education reservation has certainly helped because everywhere there has to be reservation. In engineering colleges, medical colleges and all other colleges, there is a reservation, so they are able to get it. With some relaxation, they get the admission. There are dropouts, but that's okay. And then once they get education, they get into the job. A political reservation with all this problem that we are able to send only the nominal member who works on the advice and under the pressure of the high caste political party. But nevertheless, in the parliament, there are 82 scheduled castes and half and about 40 scheduled tribe. There is a say SCST parliamentary forum. They act and they sometimes take decision and position whenever there are major problem and major issues. So the member in the parliament, they influence policies. There are committees attached to the ministries. Those committees make recommendation. And through the representative, the policy is being affected. Positive policy steps are taken. There are limitation of that. That's another story. But political power help to avoid at least some of the decisions. So I think the reservation policy has helped. The point is that we still find the Dalit to be very poor, less educated and all that. The reason is that the reservation policy job is applied only to the private sector, which is very tiny sector. If you take the total employee, a regular salaried employee in the country in India, only 20% are in government. Rest of them are in private sector. 80% of the regular salaried and other jobs are in private sector where there is no reservation. And therefore, there is a huge underrepresentation. And therefore, income is low, unemployment is there, and poverty is high. But reservation has helped. Praveen, there is an article of mine, if you can see it, or I will try to send me an email. Why there is an opposition for reservation? And I have answered all these questions. That is the reservation, or it's not helping poor? I answered it and rejected the argument that reservation is mainly helping the poor among the scheduled castes. Then should there be economic criteria for reservation? I refuted that no, caste should be the criteria. Does the reservation lead to inefficiency? These are the popular argument against reservation policy. There are studies which say that the scheduled castes are as efficient as the high caste in public administration. In the higher position A and B, it is found that the scheduled castes are more efficient than the high caste because they are blamed that they are not efficient, so they work hard. So there also I build up the argument that since the reservation policy is applied to private public sector, it should be extended to private sector. But in addition to the reservation policy, we need a compensation policy, reparation. Sarita and you people are familiar with the reparation policy in the United States. You know, since we were denied right to land and right to entrepreneurship, and denial of right to land and entrepreneurship and education, to the Dalit resulted into the benefit to the high caste. High caste benefited at the cost of the Dalit. They were denied education, so high caste had education, so they were eligible for a job. Then Dalit were denied right to land, but the right to land was given to the high caste, so they benefited from the land. So whatever was to be given to the Dalit has been appropriated by high caste. They should be given. Now it is the time that high caste repay it as a social debt because they benefited as a sacrifice of the Dalit. The second, third generation is benefiting now. If the education rate is high among the scheduled caste, simply because for generation together, the education was given to them and it was denied to scheduled caste. So we should ask for a reparation policy, compensation policy, in addition to the reservation policy. So there should be a program of land distribution for Dalit. There should be a program of giving entrepreneurship for Dalit. There should be a program of education, scholarship and funding for Dalit in addition to the educational reservation. Then only there will be a substantial improvement in the life of Dalit in Nepal.
Yeah, exactly. We need to talk about the this is a very important point you mentioned.
You should develop a program demand for reparation, for compensation, for denial of equal right in education, land and industry.
Yeah, one of the political party actually raised the one time about this issues, but they left out this agenda when they became a power holder when they were in the state when they were in the government. So they left out from this agenda. Actually, they raised this agenda especially in the Maoist movement, but they left out when they reached in the government. So we need to again re, uh, re, uh, address this agenda. So that's a great thought. Actually, we will raise about these issues.
Yeah,
so,
but also you should have a, I have not still understood the political reservation in Nepal. I'll try to talk to you. You have two, proportional and general. But you should have a electoral method for the reserve constituencies where only Dalit can send the Dalit candidate, elect Dalit candidate. Then you will have an independent Dalit candidate and they will be free. They will not be afraid of raising this demand of compensation or many other demand.
So far, we don't have this policy. We need to fight for this, actually.
Yeah.
So we while constitution drafting time in back in 2013-14, there's a lot of issues arise on this around this agenda. But when we have a new constitution in 2015 September, we don't have this policy. So hopefully we need to readdress this agenda, and then maybe we need to create pressure from the movement for this issues. So let me ask you one question. What are the major challenges and limitation and solution of reservation policy?
No, major challenges of reservation policy in India, which I believe will also be in Nepal. One is that it is only confined to the public sector, that the government and the public sector undertaking and all that. Now, as there is a privatization of public sector undertaking, privatization of education. So whenever privatization happens, there is a de-reservation. So that is one of our danger. Now the reservation policy in job had been reduced to a very small proportion because of privatization. So one challenge is that the reservation policy should be extended to the private sector, and at different level of position, they should have their share in proportion to the population. So that is the first reform that we need. Reservation policy in job, both public and private sector. Similarly, reservation policy in admission to the higher education institution and school education, both in public and private sector. Today, there is no reservation in private sector. So that is the first issue. Second issue is political reform. As I say, that the present reservation, political reservation is such that there is only one candidate and the candidate is elected by the majority vote, and since the high caste in the constituencies are in majority, it is they who elected the candidate, mostly from their political party. There is no independent, even if there is an independent Labour Party, independent Dalit Party, their vote is small, so they cannot send their own candidate. So we need a reform in political electoral system whereby the reform should be such that the Dalits should be able to elect their own candidate. Then we will be able to send independent and real candidate who will fight in the parliament. That is the another reform that we need as far as the reservation policy is concerned. Third is that there is a constant tendency in India to oppose reservation inside the bureaucracy in public sector job. So there is a huge backlog. Posts are not filled. There is a discrimination. So that is one of our problem, that how do we deal with that internal discrimination within the bureaucracy, whereby the reservation is delayed, at time bypass. So there are certain policies which are needed there. We don't have, another thing is that there are several government sector where there is no reservation. Military is one of them. Judiciary is another. Then there are several commission. You have at least reservation in Public Service Commission. We don't have reservation in Public Service Commission. Union Public Service Commission or State Service Commission. So there are many commissions. Judiciary is excluded from the reservation. Ambedkar even asked for a reservation in executive. And now what is executive? Executive is the ministers. So there has to be certain proportion of the scheduled caste who are minister, and certain ministers should be given to them so that they can implement. So these are some of our challenges that we face. I think there are lessons for you, if at all there are lessons there.
Yeah, executive is very important, you mentioned, and we have right now in our federal government, that's 25 minister, and out of 25, only one minister we have. And then we have a 7 province government, and then there's more than 50 minister in province government, but we have only one state minister in one province. So it's a really, really pathetic situation in representation, especially in executive.
Yeah, and this is especially when there is a communist government and communist party is strong. I think one has to convince the communist government. I remember when I was chairman of UGC, a delegation from Nepal had come to me and they were discussing about constitutional provision. My institute also organized a couple of discussion. At that time, I could see that communists were confused. They thought that by giving special representation to the scheduled castes, we are distorting the concept of equality. So I think the communists should be convinced that there is a difference between the high caste worker and the scheduled caste worker. High caste worker doesn't face discrimination. Scheduled caste worker does face a discrimination. So there is a need for policy of reservation for a scheduled caste worker, even if he is a member of the communist party. That that protection the high caste doesn't require. So I think you have to deal with that issue.
Exactly. We need to deal in this issues, and we're raising a voice on this issues from the beginning, and then we are pressuring to this government actually. So you mentioned about the main thing is you are talking more on the political representation, right?
No, both. Political reservation, job reservation, reservation in procurement for entrepreneurship of Dalit at all level. All level.
Okay.
Political reservation is there, and if there is no reservation in job, there is no reservation in education, no economic development will come up. Please remember.
Actually, please go ahead.
Dr. Ambedkar, right from the beginning, from the first memorandum in 1920, second memorandum in 1930, and then later on till the Constitutional Assembly, he talked of three reservations simultaneously. Political reservation, reservation in job, and reservation in education institution, and development of education. And then he talked about reservation in executive, even reservation in policy-making bodies, you know. There are policy-making bodies in the ministry, so there should be representation of the scheduled caste. So I'm talking of all the reservation. Again, I'm talking of both public and the private. And again, I'm talking that beyond reservation policy, you require a reparation and compensation policy for giving them the land, giving them the entrepreneurship and development of education through educational fund. That is the package I'm talking about. I am at the moment not discussing the discrimination in this civil sphere, where we have an anti-interchangeability act, atrocity act, that you are not allowed to have access to the public veil, you are not allowed to have entry into the temple, you cannot walk on the road. When you are in the panchayat office, you are asked to sit separately, you are given a tea in a separate cup. The social and cultural and civic right I have not discussed. I am talking of only political, government job, education, reservation in executive, reservation in policy making, and both public and private. That is the package I'm talking about.
So when we talk about the reservation, especially I used to work with the young people a lot. And then when we talk about the reservation, there's a young people have a misconception. When we talk about the reservation, and there's issues are always come about the meritocracy. So can you all about share about the meritocracy, and young people have, when we talk about the reservation, there's always issues around this.
No, we too have a big moment now in this very city where I'm speaking from, Nagpur. That is Save the Merit and Save the Nation. There is a campaign. Now, the important point is that you talk about merit. The Dalit have less proportion of population with higher education, professional education. So a small number of them try to take a job. Now the point is that in the past, the high caste have denied us education, and as a result of which we could not take education. It is only the high caste which monopolized education. Therefore, they were only eligible for employment, and the scheduled caste Dalit were not there. Now you say that that time, you know, when Indianization of the bureaucracy was the demand, because there were Britishers in the bureaucracy, and Indian people were asking that we should have a share in the bureaucracy. That time the argument was not merit. That time the argument was share, that Indians should have a share in bureaucracy, subject to the minimum qualification. That time merit was not the only criteria. Merit along with qualification, share was there. Now, the Dalit do not have a share in bureaucracy. We are asking for a share. And now the same very high caste who got the share in the bureaucracy on the basis of the argument of the fair share vis-a-vis the British, now they are talking of merit. So it is agreed. It is agreed. In the Constitution of India, there is a provision which Dr. Ambedkar made, subject to the minimum qualification, not higher qualification. Whatever minimum qualification you require for a particular position, take that minimum qualification, give a share to the Dalit. The argument given by Dr. Ambedkar, he draw a distinction. Efficient administration and good administration. Efficient administration is that only you apply a criteria of education. But if you apply only criteria of merit and education alone exclusively, then in that case, the Brahmin and the high caste who were given education, only they will get into the bureaucracy. But this is not a good governance, good bureaucracy, giving only one section the share in the bureaucracy and denying to the others. Good governance, good administration demand that other also get a share subject to the minimum qualification, not the over qualification. Because you are more educated because thousands of years you have access to education at the cost of denial to us. What we are saying, minimum qualification, because to work you require a qualification, fine. But you cannot say that take the highest person because the Brahmins are highly educated, the scheduled caste should also be measured by that standard. No, measure by the standard which is required in running the administration. If there is a qualification for a class 4 employee, according to job, prescribe that. If there is a class 3 employee, there is a minimum qualification to do the work, prescribe that. But you cannot say that no, under for a clerk position, the person who is higher secondary 12th can do the work. No, we will take MA because MA is and BA is available among the high caste. This is agreed. This is agreed for the, on the part of the higher caste to appropriate the job which they have been appropriating. So this is the argument, my argument in favor of merit. There is no merit there. There is only the desire to have more and more job. So have minimum qualification, the qualification which will be necessary to work and to do the work in the office. Don't go to the higher education. If you have merit alone and only the job by the higher caste are taken, it is not an efficient administration. It is the administration which is discriminatory. It is a policy which excludes the Dalit on the name of merit.
Yeah, I have one question from Sikha Kiran. As we all know, Dalit women are much more vulnerable state, though government have a reservation set for Dalit women, but still they are not in leadership position. What kind of political social change you think it's possible in policy level regarding reservation of girls and women?
Yes, I think the point is that the caste system not only deny right to education and other rights to the untouchable as a whole, but they also denied the equal right to women and to women irrespective of their caste. High caste, low caste, middle caste women were denied right to education, at least in India. So as a result, they remain illiterate and the education level been low. Their share in the employment is government employment and private employment is less. And but beside the denial of equal right in education and many other sphere because of the caste. Women also suffer from discrimination in basis of the gender and sex. Because they are women, they are not given equal opportunity by the higher caste, by the government, but also by the scheduled caste themselves, by the Dalit themselves. The Dalit men get more chances than the Dalit women. So what you require is that there should be special program for promotion of education, for giving special space them in the public sectors, also in politics. Because women have been, irrespective of caste, women have been neglected under political reservation for the Dalit, but also general politics, women are not there in proportion to their population. In India, about 14 to 16% of women are in the parliament as against their population share of 50%. Therefore, women for last 10 years are asking for a political reservation. 33% post in the parliament, they are asking. But it has not been given as yet. There is a different issue involved in that. Dalit women are asking their own share within the 33%. Muslim women are asking their share in 33% because they fear that there will be discrimination. Even if there is a reservation for women, the bulk of the position will be taken by the high caste woman. But nevertheless, since women are neglected in political representation, they have asked for a reservation. So for Nepal, I think both for women, there should be a reservation to give them the fair share. But within the women, there should be appropriate share for the Dalit woman in politics, in employment, in education. In education, there should be special program for education development of the woman, Dalit woman particularly, scholarship, special scholarship, hostels, other facilities, so that their education level is improved on par with the Dalit men, and also for the non-Dalit woman. There are gender disparity, there are caste disparity. So you do require a special policy, special support for Dalit woman, and as well as the woman in general. But high caste women now, they are, because they are economically now well off, they are getting into the higher education and they are getting into the job. It is the Dalit woman which are lagging behind, both because of caste discrimination and as well as gender discrimination. And also, as they say, because of poverty. So they talk about Dalit women's the triple discrimination, poverty, caste and gender.
So this is my last question for you. Do you have any message for especially young people? So when we talk about the reservation, I already mentioned that people have issue of meritocracy and all, and there's a misconception about the reservation, especially among young people. So what would be your message for young people to eliminate caste discrimination and about the reservation?
See, generally, you will see both in India and Nepal, there is a tendency to oppose policies for the Dalit. There is an antagonistic feeling because they are given reservation. This is despite the fact that the deprivation of the Dalit is because of the enrichment of the high caste. And since there is no realization, there is no feeling of guilt that Dalit situation is there because of us. So there is generally an antagonism. And you can see that antagonism in the civic sphere, you know, atrocity on Dalit and denial of access to public services and all that. Similarly, there is a reservation, opposition in reservation in politics. Now, the way the political representation come in Nepal, why is that come? The reason is internally, they don't want to support it, both communist or otherwise. So there is always an opposition. Now this, and then there are several arguments which are brought in, you know, merit, that the reservation policy is benefiting the criminal layer, better off, and neglecting the poor. All kind of arguments are brought against reservation policy. My suggestion to the youth will be the following, and that is Dr. Ambedkar's slogan, educate, agitate, and organize, or rather educate, organize, and agitate. In order to defend and in order to face the arguments of the higher caste and others, you have to educate yourself, read, write, and defend. Education, I am not talking of education for education development. I am talking of education for understanding your problem and dealing with the criticism of the higher caste and facing them and writing them. You have to have a continuous intellectual and educative propaganda. Yourself, bringing out the book, what is Samta Foundation is doing. I saw so many books in the rack. So education is very important. Ignorant people cannot defend them. It is the literate people and educated people who understand the problem, they can defend them. So that is the first thing I am saying, that continuously, you should write continuously. I am doing that. I have set up an institute, Indian Institute of Dalit Study, along with other Martin McQuan and others, Paul Diwakar, these were the people who set up that institution. Now that institution produced literature. It bring out the status of Dalit in India. You should bring out the status report because people do not believe what is the status of untouchable. So you should bring out a status on poverty. You should bring out a status report on landlessness. You should bring out a status report on untouchability, which you do. So education is very, very important, and transparency and bringing to the notice. That is the first thing. Second thing is, of course, you have to organize. Unless you do not organize and make a noise and make a difference, it is very difficult. The civil society should organize for different purposes and agitate. That is the third one. You have to agitate, come on the street, fight with the government constantly for right policies, make the noise, bring out the problem. So educate, organize and agitate, very important. But ultimately, what is also important is that civil society have a role to play. But the civil society rights, agitate and organize with the government who make the policies. There is no guarantee that they will accept the policies. You know, you have seen the situation. So Dr. Ambedkar then suggested the one of the important alternative that you have to get into the government. You have to get into the power where you make the policies. If you are in power, you can make the policies then. Now, how to get into the power? The only way is to have a political party, but you are in minority. Even if all Dalit are united, they are in minority. So the first step is to have a political party, unite Dalit, and then in the election, have an alliance with the political parties which accept your demand. There is a manifesto of the Scheduled Caste Federation, which Dr. Ambedkar prepared. He laid down the principle of political alliance. First, you have a political party. Then you have a political alliance with the political party, majority political party, who will accept your demand, both policy demand as well as sharing of power. That you should say, we will support you provided you make two ministers of power and that you accept this, our policy. So once you go into the government, you get a little power, if not more, you can take policy decision. Policies are very important. Talking in the ear doesn't help. Academic argument doesn't help. You have to have a policy and the scheme. It is the reservation policy which has brought change among the scheduled caste in India. It is the reservation political policy which has given the place to the scheduled caste in the parliament where they shout. It is the reservation policy in education which has increased the education and helped them to get a job in the government services. Policy is very, very important, which then there are problem of implementation. That is another story. Now, so that is very important, getting into the policies and policy making body. Now, there are no political parties. They are very weak. Those are the problem. The civil society organization should organize the Dalit, agitate, and they also play a political role during the election time. That we will vote you, we will help you to vote in these many people, provided you accept this demand. So civil society should also play a political role in a way. They are not a political party, but they should play a role in a way that support those people, those political parties, which will accept your demand and put it into practice. I think there is no alternative except you organize, except you show your strength, and that the high caste political parties or communist political parties recognize that if we need a support, we have to do something for the Dalit. Political unity is the only solution. Otherwise, they can always crush you. You are in minorities.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Professor Thorat. Wonderful talking with you. Thank you very much for joining with us today. If you want to say anything in last minute, or I'm planning to wrap up. Do you want to say anything?
No, I will only say one thing that I'll end up by expressing my appreciation to the Dalit civil society organization. I think you people are hope that you sacrifice and you work. So civil society is mobilization and organization and continuous fighting and keeping the issue of Dalit alive is a very important moment. Samta Foundation, you know, he has done a wonderful work. Sarita Periyar is carrying forward. You people are carrying forward. You should continue to carry forward. You have make a very good progress in the mass media and developed several Dalit journalists. I am, in fact, copying that. I had sent one Indian journalist to, along with Vinod Mishra, to learn your model of radio, community radio, and developing the reporter, a journalist. So I'm very happy. I end with my appreciation for you people's effort, your national and international engagement and work for the cause of the Dalit. Thank you very much for inviting me here.
Thank you. Thank you for inspiring all the time. We learn a lot from you. We feel when we talk with you, we feel you are our mentor. Thank you. Thank you so much for that. Thank you, Professor Thorat. Thank you very much for joining with us today. We have come to the end of today's episode of Caste Conversation. On behalf of Dalit Lives Matter Nepal, I want to thank you, everyone, for your solidarity. If you want to if you have any ways to talk, any agenda or any issues, you can write us also in daritlivematter@gmail.com. I'm also thankful to my friends, Bridika, Vijay, Vikas, Roshan, for making this possible. Friends, we'll see you next week with another guest to talk about the caste question in caste conversation. This is Pradeep Pariyar signing off for today. Namaste, stay safe wherever you are. Stay happy, stay healthy. Let's fight together to end caste discrimination. And on to
Okay. Thank you. Thank you. Bye. Bye. Thank you.